the speaker of the seminar is Jeffrey Kovac, eminent researcher and thinker in the area of ethics and science. And with this, I will just hand over to Christoph Kopperer, who will actually give you the introduction of the speaker of today.
Thank you, Karl-Heinz. Thank you, everyone, for coming today. I think we can move forward, because at the end of the day, what we want to do is to have a discussion. So I think, as far as I know, the plague has not arrived in Tennessee yet. So I think I would suggest you that you move forward for the discussion. In any case, so it's my pleasure to have today Jeff Kovacs. The reason why we started that, actually, it's part of a program of the Swiss Academy of Science, Platform Chemistry. We realize how much pressure there is today in science in publishing. And it's clear that if science wants to survive, I would be political, the Trump era maybe, we have to be very careful what we do. And if you want to do very careful what we do, we need to think about everything we write, everything we say is accurate. And this is part of the reason why in the Academy of Science in Switzerland, we decided that to organize basically lecture tours in a yearly fashion that you get acquainted to the problem that you might face as a student, as a faculty, and then something you have to respond to it, because you know, we are facing every day question, and we need to give answers, and sometimes it's actually not obvious how we are going to give an answer. So it's a pleasure today that we have actually our first inaugural speaker, Professor Kovacs from Tennessee. So first, let me give you briefly his background, because the goal today is to discuss, not so much to discuss who we are. So Jeff Kovacs actually was trained as a surgical chemist in the 70s at Yale University. And then he did a postdoctoral fellowship in MIT, and then moved up to Tennessee to start his independent career, and he moved up the ranks, basically. And he was basically mainly interested in understanding polymers, basically, from a theoretical point of view. And then, you know, over lunch, we had time to discuss about many things, and the question is obviously, how do you move from polymer science and theoretical chemistry to ethics? And well, he actually came to that point, basically, thinking about World War I. You know, it's actually quite amazing that 6 months after the war started, I learned that today we started to use chemical weapons. So as a chemist, you need to think about, you know, what we do and what will be your impact on society. And with that, basically, as you know, in research, sometimes you get carried away in your own little playground. And then he became very passionate about, he was passionate about philosophy. His wife is a lawyer, so they had many time to discuss about your action in life. And based on that, basically, he moved into more philosophy and ethics in science. So without further ado, I'm happy to have Professor Jeff Kovac here today to discuss about basically ethics in science or being an ethical chemist. Thank you, Professor Kovac.
Thank you. Well, thanks for the very kind introduction. It's really a singular honor for me to be the first speaker in this series of lectures that have been organized by the Platform Chemistry and the Swiss Academy of Sciences. But more important, I want to congratulate the Platform Chemistry and the Swiss Academy in organizing this. I've been an advocate for ethics education in chemistry and science more generally for over 20 years. And Switzerland has taken the lead in giving it prominence. And so you need to congratulate yourselves as a country and as an organization for doing this. I hope that, for example, my own country, the American Chemical Society, will do something similar. So this is really a great thing. This is my fourth stop of six. So by the time I get to Basel on Friday, I might be exhausted. But so to give you an idea of where I'm from, the University of Tennessee, many of you don't know U.S. geography, just as I didn't know Swiss geography, is in the Tennessee River Valley to the west of the Appalachian Mountains, which are the mountain range that runs down the east coast of the U.S., and we're at the southern edge. And the mountain range just to the east of us is called the Great Smoky Mountains. These are, unlike the Alps, which are spectacular, these are old, gentle mountains, worn down by geological time. And they're often shrouded in mist, which is why we call them the Smoky Mountains. almost every university in the U.S. and many in Europe, I'm sure, have a signature building that they put on, you know, their website, on their posters and so forth. This is the one at the University of Tennessee, Ayers Hall, up on the top of a hill, which was a Civil War battle site during the American Civil War. This is not a photo. It's actually a painting by Kelsey Roy, who's a graduate of this program that I have the pleasure of directing, which is the Interdisciplinary Honors Program in Arts and Sciences at the University of Tennessee. So I have students ranging from art students to science students and everywhere in between doing creative things. That's a lot of fun for me. As you know from the introduction, I was educated as a physical chemist. My only formal training in philosophy was 4 semesters of philosophy as an undergraduate at Reed College long ago. So when I started thinking about this, I felt a little bit like this person in the cartoon. Moral values for dummies, that's what I was. But one of the things I've learned as a scholar is that when you start a new field and don't know much, find other people who can teach you about it. So on the next slide, I have names of various people that I have learned from over the years. Some of them are philosophers. A couple of them are chemists. As was mentioned, the last one is my wife, who's an attorney, and we sometimes have very interesting conversations about the difference in ethics in our two fields. And I also got to start with a very small grant many years ago from the Camille and Henry Dreyfus Foundation. If you don't know who the Dreyfuses were, they were Swiss chemists from Basel, and they made a fortune in the textile industry. They founded what was known then, I don't know what it's called now, the Celanese Corporation in textile fibers. And they give small grants in chemical sciences in the U.S. So the question is, what is an ethical chemist? And I want to start by identifying 4 characteristics that I think are essential to being an ethical scientist. This is not original with me. I learned this from my friend Michael Davis, who was a professional ethics scholar at the Illinois Institute of Technology. And I'll go through them, the 4, and then we'll talk about them in more detail. So the first one is understand the ideals. I think ideals are important, and standards that govern professional moral decisions. And we'll talk more about what I mean by professional moral decisions. The second is to understand the moral complexity of real-world situations. Third, then be able to design solutions to complex moral problems. Chemists should be good at this because we're designers, aren't we? We design molecules, we design syntheses, we design instruments. And finally, have the moral courage to make those difficult decisions and to stand up and say why I did it. I tried to find somebody who was a chemist who could be an example of moral courage, but nobody knows the pictures of chemists, and so I picked an iconic figure in U.S. history, Martin Luther King Jr., as my example of moral courage. So, to introduce the idea of professional ethics, I want to contrast it with what philosophers call the common morality. So, common morality are those universal rules of human conduct that we expect all people to adhere to. Now, you all know them. Don't kill, don't steal, don't cause harm, etc. And I understand there are some differences across cultures, but ultimately, it's really essential to have these rules, these standards of behavior. Otherwise, we couldn't have human society. If we couldn't trust that the people we talked to on a day-to-day basis were mostly telling us the truth, we'd be in trouble. And if you were subject to random killings by your neighbors, human society wouldn't operate. So these are important, and we all know them. We learned them from our parents, from our teachers, from our ministers, you know, various sources. And we're all really good, or at least pretty good, at making these decisions and making good decisions, right? If not, we'd probably be in jail right now, because that's what happens to people who make really bad decisions. Common morality is universal, as much as anything can be universal, but professional ethics are special. These are the rules that are adhered to by people we call professionals. And what I mean by professional is not that you get paid for what you do, but you're part of a group of people who come together, generally have a specialized education, some kind of process of certification, whether it's a license or just, you know, getting a PhD. who are engaged in a common pursuit. So physicians, doctors, lawyers, architects, engineers. These are professionals. And to facilitate, to further the practice of these professions, they agree on certain standards. And these standards, which usually involve a code of ethics, go beyond the demands of ordinary morality. For example, the rule of patient and client confidentiality that doctors and lawyers adhere to is really essential to what they do. And that's not something we're all expected to do. You know, if someone tells you a secret, you probably wouldn't reveal it. But would it be considered a breach of ethics to reveal a secret? No, probably not. You might lose a friend. There might be retribution. But it's not a breach of ethics. And it's not a requirement of human life that we keep all the secrets. They also can't be requirements of law, because law is law and morality is something different. There are things that are illegal and not immoral, and things that are immoral and not illegal. You may not have thought of that, but adultery is considered immoral in most societies, but it's not illegal. It's not illegal. And it can't be a pressure of the market. You know, there are people who don't have codes of ethics who behave well because the adjoining shopkeeper, the adjoining car sales lot, etc. You know, if we look worse than them, we're not going to get business. I think, and again, I take this from my friend Michael Davis, that professional ethics derive from moral ideals, and I like ideals because they're aspirational. They make us better people if we follow ideals. As Michael Davis has written, it comes from an old idea that the profession is a calling, that you don't do it just to make money, just to have prestige, but you do it because it's what you really care about. It's part of your essence. That certainly was with me in science. I've wanted to be a chemist since I was about 15 years old. And I couldn't do anything else. I guess I could have done something else, but really that's what fulfilled me. Although I've drifted a bit. It's the basis of an ideal of service. And an ideal of service, for example, for lawyers, and that's the one I know best other than scientists, is equal justice under law. And the best lawyers believe that. And that's why they're in it. For physicians, curing the sick. And as I said, it goes beyond ordinary morality. Now, it's relatively easy, and people have talked about the moral ideals of lawyers, doctors, architects, engineers, and so forth. But I think for chemists and scientists generally, it's a little more complicated. And so one of my own contributions has been to put together what I call a three-part set of moral ideals. The first one has to do with the integrity of the scientific process, responsible conduct of research, and this relates to what we do in the laboratory on a day-to-day, week-to-week basis. And I'll elaborate on this. I call it the habit of truth. But science is not private knowledge. It's not something you can discover in your own lab in whatever you do. It has to be communicated and then scrutinized and then approved, ratified by the rest of the community. Unless you publish it and people say, yeah, that's a good discovery, it's not yet science. It's not yet science. Because it could turn out to be wrong. Some of the things I've published have turned out to be wrong. So what can you do? And finally, science is useful, particularly chemists. In fact, chemistry is the most useful of scientists. We make stuff that people want, you know, pharmaceuticals, ranges from pharmaceuticals to better shampoos. and people need all of that stuff. And that's one of the things that chemistry has done for our society, for human society throughout. So the question is, if there are uses, what uses should we aim for? What things should we be working on in the ideal? And I call that shared fate individualism. Okay. So, I think that science is about discovering the truth about the natural world. Now, if truth is a difficult word for you, if it's too loaded a word, maybe it's not, you know, truth is a kind of a abstract concept, you can say reliable knowledge about the natural world. That's John Zimon's term. And I take the phrase from This is the first book on scientific ethics I ever read back in high school. Jacob Bronowski was a Polish mathematician. And he was one of the first people to go into Hiroshima after the atomic bomb attack. And he was so horrified by what he saw, as you might expect, that he spent a lot of the rest of his life trying to put together ethics and science for himself. It's a book still worth reading, back from 1956. Einstein, I was in Einstein's apartment in Bern yesterday, just absorbing, maybe trying to absorb some genius, but I'm not sure that it worked. But nonetheless, Einstein liked this kind of Old Testament language, and he called it discovering the secrets of the Old One, whatever he meant by Old One and whatever you mean by Old One. Richard Feynman had a slightly different view of it, but the same thing, which was a principle of utter honesty about your data, about what you've done. Make sure that you not only tell them what you believe, but what might be wrong about it. Let people, let the community think about it. And finally, I like this one, P.W. Bridgman, who was one of the founders of modern high-temperature, high-pressure science, said the scientific method is no more than doing one's damnedest with one's mind, no holds barred. And we all know science is hard. So, as I said, these are things that we have to pay attention to in our own labs on a day-to-day basis, week-to-week basis. But, as I said, science is public knowledge. It has to be communicated. So what's the ideal about communication? And I want to introduce you to an idea that you probably not run into. It's called the gift economy. I learned about it from a philosopher of science named Davis Baird, whose father actually was a physicist. And he introduced me to this wonderful book by Lewis Hyde called The Gift, Imagination and the Erotic Life of Property. And when I saw this title, I said, I have to read that book because I have to figure out what in the world he means by erotic life of property. Lewis Hyde is a very thoughtful scholar of these kinds of things. Still around, still writing, still saying things that are worth hearing. Lewis Hyde contrasts the two economies in which we all live. One of them is the commodity economy. And the commodity economy is designed to give us mutually beneficial closed interactions. Fee for goods, fee for service. You go to the store, want a loaf of bread, you give them the price, you get your bread, your baguette, whatever bread you pick out, they get their money, everybody's happy. We do this every day, many times a day. But it's closed. We walk out of the store and maybe we go back, maybe we don't. We don't want a close personal relationship with the friendly person behind the counter. I guess maybe you might because you happen to find that person interesting or attractive, but nonetheless, you don't do that with every person in a bakery or in the shoe store or the person who serves you lunch, right? Gifts are different, the gift economy, but we all live in it. It's much smaller, and it's very different. And the way you should think about it is, to whom do you give gifts, and why do you give them? Well, you give gifts to people you care about, your family, your closest friends, right? And why do you give gifts? You give gifts to either establish or maintain a human relationship. That's what gifts are really about. And my wife's birthday is coming up in a couple of weeks. I've thought a lot about what to give her because I want it to be something she will appreciate, but I also want it to be representative of our relationship. As it says here, the only gift is a portion of thyself. I've been married a long time, 43 years, and I don't want to screw it up. But if you think about it, isn't that what you do when you give a gift to somebody you care about? you know, there are these obligatory exchanges that people do at Christmas time and, you know, that kind of thing. But if you really get the gifts that you really care about, or you think about them this way. And that's a very small... Okay. But now think about what we do as chemists. We go onto our laboratory, go to the computer lab, wherever it is that we do our work. We use our creativity, and we also use the contributions of those who have come before. Those are the gifts that have been passed down to us by our predecessors. You know, you read the literature, you learn things, you use those things, and then you use your creativity to make a new discovery, you hope, and then you publish it, present it at a meeting. You give the gift to the community. And if you're lucky, your gift is such that someone else will come back to you 5 years later or 2 years later and say, you know, I read that paper, and it was great. I learned something from it, and I was able to use it in my work. And I did this with it. For the students, this has probably not happened to you yet, but for those who have done science, there's hardly a bigger, better high than having somebody say, I really loved that paper, and I was able to use it. It's really a great feeling. So the gifts move. And what gifts do is they bind people together. They create a community. That's how you get to be part of the scientific community, by publishing stuff and having people read it. Unless you do that, you're not doing science. You can be doing something else, but you're not doing science. Okay, so... And the neat thing about the gift economy, which I love, is that in the gift economy, as opposed to the commodity economy, the people who are most respected are those who give the most. In the commodity economy, it's all those rich people, right? Pick your favorite or least favorite rich person, U.S. Warren Buffett or Bill Gates or somebody like that, Steve Jobs, although he's now dead. But if you think about the scientists you respect the most, those are the ones who have done the most for us. Linus Pauling, R.B. Woodward, G.N. Lewis, you know, pick whoever you like. Now, uses of science. And this is probably the most controversial thing that I've come up with. And I was stimulated by an article I read about 20 years ago. Well, let's say it this way. Sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. The context for this is what I call the quadrant model for research, which comes from Donald Stokes. Donald Stokes was a science policy guy, and he noted that the usual dichotomy on a line between pure research and applied research, it really doesn't work very well. That there are, in fact, two motivations for research. One of them is the quest for fundamental understanding, getting down to what nature is about. And that can be very high or very low on your priorities. He made it binary, but it's probably actually a non-binary scale. But there's also the consideration of use. So he pointed out that there's some research which we call pure basic research, and he called that Bohr's quadrant. And these are things that have no obvious use at the time. Maybe 100 years from now, 20 years from now, they might have a use. But right now, you're just interested in the, you know, creating quantum mechanics or whatever it happens to be. And that's, as a theorist, that's where I spent most of my career. Theorists don't do much that's useful. There's also, well, I should maybe shouldn't say that. At least the theory I did was not very useful. There's also pure applied research, and he characterizes it with Edison. Edison didn't contribute to the scientific community in any basic knowledge at all. He wasn't interested in that. But he certainly was interested in taking scientific knowledge and turning it into useful products. And he did things like, you know, develop the light bulb and the phonograph and the movie projector and all kinds of things. Nothing wrong with that. But the most interesting area, and this is where most of chemistry is, or at least a lot of chemistry is what he called use-inspired basic research, where the end use is something that you're looking for. You're interested in a better pharmaceutical, a better textile fiber, whatever it happens to be. But in the process, you do something significant to basic research. And one of my favorite examples of this is Wallace Carruthers, who was a scientist at DuPont in the 1930s. Carruthers was really interested in proving the macromolecular hypothesis. Now, we don't know about this anymore, but at one time there was a question as to whether macromolecules were colloids held together by secondary interactions or whether they're covalently bonded molecules. And this was a battle. Hermann Staudinger was one of the people involved in this, and so was Carruthers. Carruthers went to DuPont and wanted to prove it by using simple organic reactions to create polymers. So fundamental research was what he wanted to do, but in the process he invented nylon, from which DuPont made many dollars. Although interestingly, DuPont doesn't make nylon anymore. They sold that capability, but nonetheless. So if we're to be in this half of the quadrant, what should we do? And I was stimulated by an article by Freeman Dyson, who said, as you can read, science is in trouble because of a poor choice of goals. Now, this is a really explosive statement. As a general rule, to which there are many exceptions, good scientists, he's qualifying everything, right? Science works for evil. Again, that's a loaded word, evil. That's, you know, think of when its effect is to provide toys for the rich and works for good, when its effect is to provide necessities for the poor. Now, if you think about that, in the context of today's world, there are two things that come to mind, one of which is the great social and inequities in the world. And if you live in Switzerland, you live in the US, you're relatively well off. Good health care, good food, good places, nice places to live, etc. Beautiful scenery here. Some in the US as well. But if you live in certain places in Africa and South America, there's really, India, there's abject poverty. And what are we doing to bring that part of the world up to a better standard of living? And then there's the long-term consequences, which have to do with, among other things, environmental degradation. You know, I'm a grandparent now, and I think about, well, what kind of world are we living for my grandchildren and for their grandchildren? And so I went to the work of a philosopher, now late philosopher at Oberlin College, Norm Kerr. Norm Kerr was an ethicist. What a great name for an ethicist, Norman Kerr. He wrote a book called Decent People. And what Norm was interested in these problems, and he said, well, there are a lot of competent individuals in the world. If you want an example, just look to the left or the right. Competent people are people like us who live in good in affluent societies, and we're positioned to self-realize, which means have great careers and great lives, but we can also contribute to the lives of others. If you live in in abject poverty, you can't, self-realization, just staying alive is what you can do. Contributing to society, well, that's a second thought. You're probably never going to do that. And what Norman Kerr said is competent individuals should, he said, must put other responsibility ahead of self-realization in significant life decisions, such as career choice. Now, you may or may not agree with his position, but for me, I put that as an ideal for science, which is that when we're choosing what we do, we should put service to others, things that are going to make the world better, ahead of career advancement, self-realization, whenever possible. And that depends on, you know, who you work for, what your competences are, etc. You know, I might think that global warming is the most important problem to work on, but I was a statistical mechanic of liquids and polymers. What do I know about global warming? What could I do to contribute to it? Probably not much. So for me, that wasn't a big issue. Maybe I should do something else. But some of you might be in a position to do something. And if you can do it, that should be your ideal. And I'm not dogmatic about this, but as I said, ideals are good. Now, the problem with ideals is they're vague and they're aspirational. They don't tell you what to do, what not to do. So people have identified certain what we call moral rules for science. These are a few of them that are important, like experimental and theoretical procedures must be reported accurately. because what you want people to do is to use your work and maybe to reproduce it. We all know that reproducing work is sometimes easier said than done, but nonetheless, it's a rule. The data should be as complete and correct insofar as you know them. We want prompt and open communication. I understand there are issues with patents and other intellectual property, but prompt and open communication is something we want. We want objective interpretation. And what I mean by that is that you don't let consideration outside of science influence your decision. So my favorite example of that is if you were to read research on the effects of smoking and health published by a scientist who worked for the tobacco companies, should you be skeptical? Of course you should be skeptical. They want to sell cigarettes or whatever kind of tobacco. So they may emphasize the non-effects. They may de-emphasize the effects. So that's something that's an economic consideration, not a scientific consideration. And then giving credit where credit is due. Who helped? Who did the work? Who helped do the work? Now, as I said, you can know the ideals, you can know the rules, but then you got to deal with the day-to-day problems, which are complex. And there are at least 8 reasons that moral problems are complex. You might think of more, and if you do, let me know. The first of them is that the fact situation could be complex. You might not know who all the stakeholders are, all the people affected. You might know all the effects, etc. That can be a problem. Often is a problem. Second, we're all citizens of a national society. I have foot 2, right? U.S. and Switzerland, but some of you may be citizens of other countries. And your country, my country, has a history. We have goals as a society, as a country, and we have certain ideals. The democratic ideal in both countries, for example. Can that affect you? Sure. Because you can't forget that you're a citizen. And you don't want to forget you're a citizen. You want to be a good citizen. A good example of that has to do with military research, which isn't as big a deal in Switzerland as it is in the U.S. But it is a place where that might be affected. You have an institutional obligation. Somebody pays your salary. And there are certain obligations. And so I put up some institutions, all the ones that I'm visiting, plus my own here. Of course, ETH is at the top. I was in Lausanne a couple of days ago, and they were at the bottom, and so I had to tell them I just screwed up. I told them they should have been at the top, right? We're all part of a professional community, and in our case, chemists and professional societies have codes of ethics. Not all of them, but most of them. The ACS certainly does. I don't think it's a very useful code of ethics, but we have one. And also, here we have the Swiss Academy of Sciences. We often get money from funding agencies, whether they're federal agencies or private companies or foundations, and they impose obligations on us, certain things that we have to do as recipients of grants and contracts. Could be an issue. We're all human beings. We have the obligations of human beings to take care of other human beings. We might be members of a particular religious tradition. Now, science is a secular enterprise, so I don't want to emphasize this, but in the individual case, your religious tradition might impact what you do or don't do. And you can't ignore it. You can't ignore it. And a good example for me is if you were a member of, say, the Society of Friends, the Quakers, then working on military-related research might be something you just don't want to deal with. And you could, within your own religious tradition, you might think of things that you should just steer away. You would want to steer away from because they conflict with that tradition. And I want to say this up front. You can't ignore self-interest. Because to be a scientist, you have to have a career. You have to have the respect of your colleagues. You have to, if you stop publishing, if you stop doing science, you won't get funded. You'll get fired, maybe, whatever it happens to be. You can't ignore this. And it's a legitimate consideration. There are financial considerations. If a moral decision caused you to lose your job and you have a family and other obligations, that's an issue, right? And you have a family, or you might have a family. I have a family, right? And I care about them. And so taking care of them is really important. Now, my kids are grown up, but still, I care about them. You never stop caring about your children. So here are a couple of examples, and we won't do them all. One of them, as I said, we talk about choosing a research project, and I wanted to skip over that, thinking about something to do. I want to talk about discarding of data points. You know, the rule is, the standard is, you report all the data. The reality is nobody reports all the data. Okay? Sometimes legitimately, because when you're doing an investigation, and those of you who've done science or are doing science know that when you start a project, you don't know what the heck you're doing, right? And you spend a number of months, maybe even years, figuring out how to do it, right? Getting the instrument to work, getting the reaction to work, getting whatever it is. You fumble around a lot. Do you report that data? No. To use a sports analogy, that's practice. Then the whistle blows, you kick the ball off, and you're taking real data. So then you get some data, and there are some here. These are not real data. I made them up. I took my Excel program and put some points into it. But the idea here is that the research advisor goes to the student and says, I think some effect, whatever it is linearly dependent on some cause. Okay, doesn't matter what it is. And the student comes back with, gets these data, and you got a pretty good straight line right here, don't you? I wouldn't be embarrassed to report a straight line like that. But the problem is you got this one and you got that one. What do you do if you're a student? Well, one thing you could do if you're the student, and your advisor is just one of those people who just pounds on the table and says, I'm right, I'm right, I'm right, you might just leave the points off. That wouldn't be the right thing to do, but you could, right? And then your advisor would be happy. But the experiment might not be correctly interpreted. You could go to your advisor and say, here are the data I've gotten. Let's think about these two points. Are they telling us something or not? Are they telling us that the linear hypothesis is wrong? Now, some of it will depend on the error bars, which I didn't put in. But the advisor might say, well, go back to the lab and repeat them. Maybe that's the right thing to do if it's a short experiment. But suppose that each of those points took a year to get. I remember doing a computer simulation back in the days when computers were older and slower, and we had one point. It took us 1,000 hours of CPU time to get it. You can't imagine 1,000 hours of CPU time now because computers are so fast. We probably weren't going to repeat that. You know? Suppose these are data that came from neutron scattering that you got at CERN. Now, for you guys, CERN's a short train ride, but if you live in Knoxville, Tennessee, it's a $2,000 plane ride. Plus, you know. So are there legitimate reasons for throwing out these points, ignoring the points or not? Are you doing it because of your expectations, or are you doing it for good scientific reasons? This is a discussion that you should be having with, that research advisors, colleagues should be having with each other. Now, an example of this, historically, is the oil drop experiment. You all know about that. Charge of the electron. Millikan looking through his little telescope, balancing his electric fields and so forth. Gerald Holton, historian at Harvard, looked at Millikan's research notebooks and realized that Millikan really believed the electron had a single charge. And he was evaluating his points partly based on whether they gave him a good number. He was doing little calculations. He reported in his paper that he was giving you all the data, but that turned out not to be the case. The black points are the ones that Millikan published, and the white points, he didn't. Now, he felt deep in his heart or somewhere, now, we can't ask him because he's dead, but nonetheless, that he was discarding these points because the experiment was not working correct. He thought he was making a good professional judgment. But you have to ask the question, was he just basing that, was he basing that on his expectation that there was a single value or not? We don't know that, but it's a temptation. And there are plenty of examples in the history of science of people who believed something was true, looked at the data, threw out the stuff that was bad, manipulated stuff that was bad in such a way to get it. And we're talking about at lunch today about Newton, who apparently wasn't very careful. There's a recent incident, a discovery of cold fusion, where they really believed they had discovered it and they played with the data. There's an incident in France at the beginning of the 20th century, the discovery of N rays by Henri Blondlot, who believed he had discovered a new ray. It turned out it was all a figment of his imagination. He wanted to build a reputation. He wanted to build a reputation of his university at Nancy. That's why they're called N rays. Turned out that they were just a figment of his imagination. So it's something that happens. Writing a scientific article or report. You know that mythology is, and I'll call it mythology, is that it's a dispassionate report on what you did. When I was in elementary school, we used to have to write what I did last summer. That's not what it's about. And as Roald Hoffman points out in this wonderful article called Under the Surface of a Chemical Article, a scientific article is a piece of rhetoric. It's a human-made creation in which you're making a case for your discovery. You're first trying to persuade yourself that you made a discovery, because sometimes you don't know. You're trying to persuade the rest of the community you made a discovery. And of course, you're trying to persuade them that it's something they should pay attention to, that it's a good discovery, it's an important discovery. Well, when you make an argument, when you make a persuasive case, what do? Well, you put all the good points at the front, and you either don't put the bad, you know, the loose ends, or you bury them in footnotes, or put them at the end, or dismiss them, right? So the question is, are you being honest with your data? Are you being honest with the community? Or are you, like Bonnot and others, just giving a case of something you want to happen that actually didn't happen? It can be an issue. There are issues of authorship, who should be on the paper, who should be first, etc. These are complicated because sometimes it's equal authorship. Do you put the person who just did a little bit on the paper or not? Which order they're in? These are complicated things that can be hard to negotiate. And then there are these different traditions. When I was publishing scientific work, I tended to put my name last and the students first. Was that the right thing to do? Well, I don't know. I had some colleagues who always put their name first because they would then build their reputation because it would be, you know, person A plus students. These can be interesting questions. Conflict of interest. These can be financial, can be professional, personal, etc. These are tugs on your judgment that have nothing to do with the decisions that's being made. So, you know, for example, financial might be, well, I think I might be able to patent this and make a lot of money. I'm a consultant for that company, etc. But I want to talk about one that, and this is going to be a little uncomfortable, but I want to talk about it, which is the interest of a senior investigator, like me, and the interest of a student. Senior investigator wants to make a reputation. It's possible for the senior investigator to downplay the contribution of a student so that his or her reputation increases. An example of this comes in the discovery of streptomycin, the antibiotic. The senior investigator was a man named Selman Waksman at Rutgers University. He won the Nobel Prize for it. And he was involved in the attempts to discover things like streptomycin. But his graduate student, Albert Schatz, was the person who actually was in the lab and discovered streptomycin. Now, in the original article, they were co-equal authors. I don't remember if it was Schatz and Waxman or Waxman and Schatz, but there were two authors. And in the patent that was filed, they were considered to be equal inventors. But as time went on, as Waxman, who was the senior guy and got all the publicity because he was the, you know, the famous guy, downplayed Schatz's role to make it appear that Waxman had made the discovery and Schatz had not. And in fact, Waxman kept all the profits from the patents, all the royalties from the patents. Waxman wins the Nobel Prize. Schatz kind of disappears into obscurity. At some point, Schatz actually filed a lawsuit to get his profits, his royalties back. But ultimately, the question is, was this guy's ego such that he couldn't accept that the graduate student actually, through the microscope, had seen this stuff? Interesting dilemma, right? Confidential information, I won't say much about it, but all of us who are working scientists get proposals, papers to review, and that's supposed to be confidential. You know, you're not supposed to use that, but you can't, once you've read it, you can't forget it. And there is a temptation. You read something that's confidential and say, boy, that would help my research program. It's an ethical question for you. Designing solutions to complex moral problems. As Carolyn Whitebeck, who's an ethicist, says, an ethics problem is not a multiple choice problem. It is a design problem because you have to devise a solution. You got to figure out what to do and then figure out what is the best course of action, because there isn't always one course of action. You have to get the right end. You got to be consistent with moral principles. You don't want to do anything immoral. You want to make sure that it's not going to fall apart, and consistent with background constraints, by which I mean things like family, financial, etc. So the example I've been using is, suppose you're an analytical chemist and you work for a lab that tests drinking water. Okay? And there are standards for impurities in drinking water. The big case in the U.S. recently has been lead in the drinking water at Flint, Michigan. But it doesn't matter what the impurity is. So you come, you go to the lab, you do your tests, verify them, and the level's too high compared to the standard. You go to your supervisor, and your supervisor says, we can't afford to do anything about that water. Just take a few points, you know, reduce it so that it's below the level. Just lie, basically, is what he's telling you, or she's telling you. I don't want to be sexist about it. So what do you do? What do you do? Well, you could try arguing with your supervisor, go back and do more tests, say this is legitimate, but that person is adamant. We can't let this happen. You could go to the supervisor, who may or not be more sympathetic, but maybe the supervisor and your supervisor go back a long way, and he says he can't possibly, he never asked you to do that. You could go to the newspapers, blow the whistle, as we say. Which is the right one? Well, if you go to the newspaper, you know, there are dangers in these things. One danger is, of course, you're going to lie, which will be on your conscience. But the other is you might get fired. You might lose your job. And if it's important to you, you know, you got a family, et cetera, obligations, losing your job could be catastrophic to you and your family. And your family's really important to you, so let's not diminish that. So there's usually more than one solution. There's usually more than one course of action. But I'm not a relativist. You know, I think there are courses of action that you have to balance. But there are some solutions that are unacceptable. You just can't do it. And in this case, you coming to work and shooting your supervisor, which would solve the problem because he'd no longer be there. You can't do that. Now, this is an extreme example, but nonetheless, there are some unacceptable solutions. they might not have clean solutions. They might be coping rather than solving. And we talked about this at lunch, and I've talked about it before. You know, there are deeply held principles which sometimes come into conflict. Would you lie to save a life? Well, we all believe in telling the truth, but we all believe in the sanctity of life. You can't not break one of the rules if you're confronted with that situation. Finally, moral courage to make those decisions. I'm sure none of you have ever done anything in your life that you later regretted because of peer pressure or because you, as we say in the U.S., chickened out on a tough decision. Of course you have. I mean, you don't, I'm not going to ask you what they are, but I've done it. There are things I did because I just didn't have the guts to do it right. We're all human beings, right? We're all human beings. So in conclusion, and I think I'm just a little over time, is what I want to say to you is that we don't have ethics over here as a philosophical subject and science over here as a non-philosophical subject. They're intertwined. That when you're in the lab, when you're writing a paper, when you're doing the things that we do as chemists, the two of them are intertwined. You cannot separate them. And if we don't think about the ethical part, one consequence is bad science and the other is scientific misconduct. And so we don't want to be in the position of this poor person here at the last judgment, if you believe in the last judgment, saying it doesn't matter that you never got caught. So thank you very much for your time. I'm happy to answer questions, listen to rebuttals, et cetera, and Professor Folkers is going to facilitate that discussion.
Thank you very much for paving the ground and giving such a deep insight in these problems that we face from day to day, probably without knowing that we might have problems. Let me a little bit play the advocate of the young.
Okay.
So the devil's advocate. No, advocatus soli.
The angel's advocate.
If I face reality, then I see that at the moment, 8 million people in the world claim to be scientists, which the definition is we publish in peer-reviewed papers.
Sure.
8 million. Sounds not too much, but think about it. It's 1 out of 1,000 of the world's population, including grandmas, babies, speed car drivers, you name it. We are going to publish roughly Smithsonian numbers. I got from the Smithsonian Institution roughly 2 million papers per year. To publish 2 million papers per year, you need to reject 4 million manuscripts, which means 6 million pieces of paper, to be reviewed by at least 3 reviews. Means 18 million reviews. So I could go ahead with that and extrapolate. So what you see is we have a tremendous massification.
Yep.
What is the problem? The problem is to show up as a person in these massive environments. So to get awareness. And so it's not only my hypothesis is. Everything that we do in the lab is getting awareness or having awareness as a currency in sciences to be able to make a career and a living at the end. And from that, you have all these stupid quantification as rating and ranking just as a tool to get the masses handled and all these outcomes that you named. So
yeah.
Lack of responsibility, fraud, omitting data, and so on and so on. So tell us something about how could this young live with the pressure?
Well, my first comment is I'm glad I'm an old guy rather than a young person. But it's difficult. I mean, it is difficult because being noticed is important. And if you're an assistant professor somewhere or a young person, you also have to be noticed in a hurry. In the U.S., if you're hired, you have about 5 years to make a reputation, which is... So I can't imagine how these people live with the pressure. I mean, when I was young, the pressure was much less. First is, of course, you should be brilliant, but that's easier said than done.
They are brilliant. Otherwise, they would not sitting here.
I know, I understand. And that's it's a tension. And one of the things I would say is, first of all, as a student, one of the things you have to learn, and you should go to your faculty members and get them to teach you this, is how to recognize when something is publishable legitimately. Because early in your career, you have to get what I sometimes call rather morbidly quick kills, easy results, because you have to be noticed. And so my advice that you should work on long-term problems that are important to society, wait till you're older. Get yourself established first. So that's number one. But I don't think getting noticed is one thing, but you don't want to get noticed the way some people do for publishing shoddy work.
Yeah, low-hanging fruits. You would not get noticed for low-hanging, getting all the easy problems.
Well, it depends on what the easy problems are.
Okay.
Some people do. No, I understand that. I wish I had an answer, but I don't have a really good answer. But I do say that cutting corners is not going to help you.
Yeah.
Ethically and in terms of integrity, because eventually they're going to figure it out.
I went into this economization problems in science. So the most stupid thing, I give you a short anecdote, is a journal that came up 2 months ago in advanced engineering.
Okay.
So maybe of some relevance for our school. So they pay back $100 to every author of an article that is cited more than 20 times per year in another journal. That's perfect. I mean, what are we talking about? Las Vegas? What has this to do with science? You come immediately to the brilliant idea, of course. You would immediately go out, leave that room here, and found a circle of mutual citation to make $100 per week or per day. So that's the easy way. So probably the editors did not think about that. You see how this develops. And in my opinion, Jeff, all the professors have the responsibility to think about cutting down their publication frequency and their publication frenzy. I mean, if we are not the person that start with this, how should they have a chance to cope with that? And so we should not get so impressed by the publishing houses. I mean, if you look up the software of Elsevier, you can make a day-by-day ranking in every field. But you need Scopus. I like it. So we somebody was objecting what I was, or what you were saying.
I cannot let that stand, Jeff, what you were just saying with regard to the future of our young generation here. Because that sounded like the future is pretty dark right now. It was so much brighter 20, 30, 40 years ago.
Well, whether it was brighter, I think the pressure was lower.
I personally would also object that one should just start with the low-hanging fruits or kind of low risk. But, once you start something, you should follow your guts. And if this is then quick research, fine. But if this is longer-term research, go for it. But the real point that I wanted to kind of make and ask you, I mean, I think this was great what you've shown us, and I think, I would hope that nobody in that room would actually object to what you've told us and made us aware of. But I think a key question, and also that goes in along the lines of what Gap was saying, is, who listens to you? Is it only us, or is it the funding organizations? Is it the governments? is it those bodies who actually are kind of setting the rules that then force our young generation to have a record that we didn't have to have when we started out? And that if I expand on that, you know, I just returned from a country that is further east, where then the salaries depend on the impact factors of the paper, where the papers get published. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this is, of course, an incredibly terrible trend in order to abide and follow what you've told us. So how far does your voice, how far does the voice of all of others who would totally support you reach?
Well, sometimes I feel like a voice in the wilderness, as they say. There is some, you know, there's some interest in this, and there have been some reports by the National Academy of Sciences in the U.S. and elsewhere to try to, you know, make people more aware of these ethical issues in science. I would say in terms, you know, one of the things that we as senior people can do, although I despair that we'll do it, is to, for example, eliminate any consideration of these impact factors, which I think are nonsense. You know, the impact factor is how many citations a journal has in over 2 years. Yeah, so, you know, normalized in some way. Well, some papers don't get noticed for 5 years, 10 years, etc. High quality work doesn't always get cited because it's, you know, for a variety of reasons. It also depends on, are you in a sexy hot field or are you in a field, another field? We should just say, you know, in our decisions on tenure, promotion, other things, we're just not going to pay attention to that. And I think if we start that, and if the prestigious institutions start to do that, you know, in Switzerland, this is a, you know, the top scientific institution, maybe the EPFL people would disagree, but, you know, let's not. But you should just say, we're not going to do that anymore. You should say, we're not going to pay any attention to the H index, which is not a very good measure. What we're going to try to do is base it on quality, and we're going to actually read the papers or have people read the papers and figure it out. But I would disagree a little bit on the quick kill versus, you know, the low-hanging fruit. If you're a young person trying to make a reputation, and in the U.S. you have 5 years, you better get some stuff out. And what I mean by learning, maybe saying low-hanging fruit is the wrong thing to do. Long-term projects can have short-term objectives which are publishable. You don't want to do what's apparently I learned is called salami science, which is slicing into the smallest possible slice. But you do want to, you need to learn how to take a long-term project and turn it into publishable units within a year or two. You also have to learn what I call the 90% solution. You know, I've written a bunch of books, and you know, people say you never finish a book, you only abandon it. Well, that's that there's some degree, some truth in any investigation, which at some point you got to say, I've got a good enough thing to publish. It may not be perfect. Maybe there's some other things. You can't be a perfectionist. I mean, you have to know when is good enough. And that's not, I don't know if I learned that as a student or not. But I've seen colleagues who didn't learn it and then didn't have a career because they never figured out how to pick out a project that's actually publishable. And so that's what I meant to say, but I said it badly, I guess. I think institutions can say about some of this stuff, these quantitative measures, but you got to go to your deans or whoever the people are who judge you as well and say, this is just nonsense. These numbers don't mean anything. Don't use them, you know, it's an ethical issue. Meaningless numbers, using meaningless numbers to judge people you know, my department head is big on student evaluation of instruction, these questionnaires that in the U.S. are passed out, you know, how did you do, et cetera. Well, my, you know, you get low response rates. The only people who do it are the people who hated you. You know, I had one student in the comments say, die, burn in hell. He must not have liked chemistry. But but is that a meaningful evaluation of my teaching? Well, maybe. I don't know. Maybe I'm that bad. But so we just have to do, I think we have to do that. And if we don't do it as senior people and we let other people tell us that it's important to use meaningless numbers, then we've made our bed and we have to lay in it.
Nick,
go ahead. Sorry. Yes.
So I wonder, is there a specific ethical chemistry?
Well, I think some of what I talked about, most of what I talked about is not unique to chemistry. Because it's...
So what would be specific?
Well, I think, and I actually have an article on this, so I've thought about it. I think one of the things that is at least, whether it's not completely unique to chemistry, is the problem is synthesis and characterization of new molecules. Chemists do that more than any other science. And there are problems or ethical issues related particularly to whether you've made what you've made, have you characterized it properly, and what are the consequences of making that? Is that substance a good substance? Is it a substance that might be bad?
If you make an explosive, yeah. It's used in tunnel
construction. Oh, I understand. It might be. Yeah, dynamite was a very useful invention. I don't know. I'm not saying that you shouldn't make it, but you need to think about the consequences. Okay, and particularly with pharmaceuticals, there are issues with side effects that are not always well appreciated. So that's one. I think analysis is another, making sure that the analytical techniques that we develop are good techniques and actually actually tell us what we say we're telling us in things like, you know, environmental analysis and so forth. I think that's a chemistry problem. And it's not that easy if you're, I'm not an analytical chemist, but in fact, that's another one. So those are two that are at least important, more important in chemistry than other places.
I would like to sharpen this view even. I would say chemistry is the only discipline that brings something new in a materialized form into a world that evolution has never seen before.
Exactly.
Biologists can do that now.
Pardon me?
Biologists can do that.
Yeah, the biologists are beginning to be able to do that.
I would say, Nick, this is an old fight that I like very much. I would say what they do in biology is working with molecules, and working with molecules is chemistry. So
let's not fight about that.
So for me, that's a clear cut. But anyway, let's.
And the other,
I agree that in cell biology and of course synthetic biology, but it's that's thinking in chemicals.
Yeah.
And then let add one sentence.
Yeah.
The problem is the same what has been discussed, for example, you named him between Bohr and Heisenberg in this famous dialogue, Schritte über alle Grenzen. When they said doing science is to make a step in the complete unknown, mm-hmm. where you even lack vocabulary, you even lack language about what you are doing. That is the exciting thing. That is doing cycling. You enter a space where you're going there. Why you want to explore the space? And you probably you can even not describe what you see there. And if you do that in terms of material, mm-hmm. and not in terms of analytical theory, so that is exciting. And I think that makes chemistry much for different to other disciplines, yeah. and gives you a much larger responsibility.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Chemists alter the world by creating new substances in a way that no other field does. As you say, biologists are beginning to do this, but not as much,
yeah,
as,
of course.
Not as much as chemists have done over the generations. And so when you create a new molecule, there's a sense in which you're creating knowledge. You're creating a substance. But there's a sense in which you're creating, as Joachim Schumer says, non-knowledge, which is then we don't know what that thing is going to do. We don't know all the things that all its effects. And so there is a responsibility of trying to understand as much as possible what that, how that's going to change the world. And that's, you know. So I don't know if I've answered the question well, but we got one more here.
We got one more, okay. Two more, yeah.
Two more.
Ladies first.
That's okay. These are complicated problems. You don't have to say them clearly the first time.
I think we were talking about creating new, let's say creating new molecules, okay? It's in this example. So we created a new molecule, and as you correctly said before, you don't know everything about it, but you want to present it, and you're happy to present it to the world, but probably that maybe is bad or good. I don't think that the bad or good is in the molecule itself, but the use of the molecule that people make. And this is, I believe, normally accepted, that the problem is that the use that you make of this molecule. My question is, so at this level, is the information that is important? So how can people know how to use the molecule, and that scientists maybe do not know everything about this molecule? So people have to be informed that maybe there is something hidden still and everything. So how do you think is the best or right way to inform people? Because we have different levels of education, different levels of information access, but now it's, I have the feeling it's kind of flat with the internet. You can just Google it and make your own idea of that.
Yeah.
But to me, this is not the right way to inform people. I know it's like a terrible field to discuss about, like, how to inform people in a correct way. But I was just asking, what is your...
Yeah. Well, you're correct that molecules, you know, uses of molecules are good or bad. Molecules are not in and of themselves bad. But it's certainly true that some substances have greater... possibility of negative things, some have great, and so, and I guess, how do you best inform people? Well, I think, of course, your first step is when you publish and, that you give as much information as, you know, and talk about the possible consequences, the possible negative effects, if you can envision them in the scientific literature. That's the first place to go. Now, how it gets out more broadly to the rest of the world is another big problem that we can talk about at great length, which is how do scientists communicate with the public through the newspapers, through the science magazines, et cetera. And there, I think things do not, there's some very good science journalists in the world, but there are also some who are rather lazier. And there are also people who, because, as was said earlier, scientists who are trying to make their reputation, who maybe will overinflate things. And you don't want to be one of those people. I don't, you know, that's a, I, you, we really do need better science journalists, better people to communicate. Maybe the, yeah, I have a suggestion for something you should not do, which is don't use Twitter. There's not much you can do that's intelligent in 142 characters. But I mean that flippantly, of course. There was a question there.
Just to summarize what you told us, what the young generation of scientists should do. So my take on what you said is you should set meaningful goals.
Yes.
That are worth pursuing, and communicating them and doing proper science. So isn't the statement, I'm not saying I disagree with your statement, I'm actually very much on your side, but isn't it an idealistic view already, again, another ideal that you that you think that the quality work will be noticed and will be worthwhile with more increasing numbers of publication, increasing numbers of bibliometric tools that are available to just break down the numbers?
Well, I'm ultimately an idealist. So I hope that's true. I understand there are forces against it, but I really, maybe it's just my own upbringing as a scientist. I think quality work will ultimately be noticed. The sad thing about that is it may take a long time. You know, but we're all trapped, we're all both enriched and trapped by our own history. And my history as a scientist is I work with people who said, do the best work you can, publish it, and someone will notice. That's maybe why I didn't have much of a reputation, because I followed that advice. But that's, you know, but I do believe that if you do it right and do work that is, and whether it's pure, you know, quote, pure work, use-inspired basic research, or even applied stuff, that you do it and make sure as much as you can that somebody can't come back and say, and find something, you know, a shortcut that you took that invalidates it. And I understand that, you know, sometimes you make mistakes, sometimes the world is not quite what you imagine it to be.
Down to a sort of a personal view, so personal standards that you should have, and also, but these standards have to be met with your advisor.
Well, they certainly, at least when you're a student, they have to match with your advisor. And, you know, one hopes that your advisor has those same really good standards. You know, this is a little bit kind of sermonizing, but there's newspaper columnist in the United States whose name is David Brooks, who writes for the New York Times. And Brooks is more conservative politically than I am, but nonetheless, he's a very thoughtful guy. And he recently wrote a column in which he contrasted what he called resume virtues versus eulogy virtues. We all have to have resume because that gets us jobs and so forth. But he said, you know, when they're saying your eulogy, I hope many years for you and for me from now, they're going to talk about what kind of person you were, not how many papers you had, how much money you made. They're going to talk about the person you have. And when you go to sleep at night, it's the kind of person that you are. If you're a good, you know, if you have that kind of integrity, you'll sleep well. And that, I understand that. I don't have a license to preach, as they say in the U.S., but that's, I really believe that. And I believe that, unfortunately, that the faculty who advise you, that's what they should be building in you as students. I think that's what, as a community, we need to be building. And I understand there we have our share of charlatans.
Should we have? I like your way to be modest and idealistic. I mean that should be the ambition. So I think we are always overselling our cases, and by overselling we put pressure on ourselves. So, but I think it's important that we understand that we, as scientists, all we together, we are shaping science. Mm-hmm. Sure. And we should not think that there is somebody around that is going to shape science. So don't think that the politicians, they always tell us, you are too expensive, you are not successful, what can I use that for that you are doing, and so on and so on. So, so that's the usual thing every day. But we should have the faith that we are going to shape science, and that is a very important process. And then we can also have the direction in which direction we shape science. Yes, Christoph.
Yeah, I think long-term view is the only way you can judge people and science. And short-term view is a derivative, and derivative has no value. So the value of cognitive behavior is based on value per time, so whatever you think. And if you look, there are two good examples. I think the Nobel Prize in Physics for Tunnel Effect was published in a proceeding to avoid being reviewed, because the people had discovered that knew very well that was a great discovery. And you don't need to publish in Science if it's a great discovery. The other one is a quasi-crystal. Mm-hmm. The guy couldn't publish anything for 4 years, and at the end had to publish in a second-rate journal, and he became another prize winner. So I think the only thing which is difficult for us, because in a world of Twitter, of millisecond information, the big problem is how to judge. And as a faculty, the only thing we can do, at ETH, because we are lucky at ETH to have funding without, raising so much money, is to forget the derivative of values and to look only at long-term, to evaluate people for what they are, what they do. Difficult question. As a professor myself, we are here for the well-being of our students. So the big problem is, if you don't publish in high-impact journals, then it's difficult to sell. But actually, it doesn't really matter at the end. It's tough work if you do that. But we are all under the same pressure. So the problem is how to relay the pressure that you don't feel so much pressure, as there is plenty of pressure. And this is a whole, it's the whole problem we have been discussing all day. Because you have to live with the real world. And the real world is about evaluation, and you will be evaluated by these stupid numbers. The only thing you can do here at ETH and in other big institutions is how to make sure that we evaluate people for what they are, not for what the numbers try to tell you.
It's interesting to look up numbers. So yesterday night the fight at the Google research, but the numbers are interesting. How many questions are asked in Google every second? 1.2 million every second. So, and this has nice consequences. This has consequences for the pressure of information you get. This has consequences for the server technology that you have to build up, and so on and so on and so on and so on. So you can expand the whole scenario about that. And that is why I think the information pressure resides on us, and that is what makes us speed up in the hamster wheel. But let's come back to chemistry.
Come back to chemistry. Do we have another?
You're drawing attention to the ease and the spread of information one can get now through Google.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think this is comparable in the history of the human race to the discovery of writing.
Yeah.
Before writing, mm-hmm. people had to rely on the memory,
mm-hmm.
and mm-hmm. nothing was written down.
Yeah.
And what had happened before was all that could be contained in the
memory. I agree. Yeah.
So this got handed down from mm-hmm. some more or less with mm-hmm. mistakes, mm-hmm. inaccuracies, mm-hmm. some mm-hmm. part mm-hmm. from generation to generation.
Mm-hmm.
What to do if there's an earthquake?
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that what you're talking about now is comparable.
Yeah.
To
yeah.
that. It's going to destroy. We don't need memory anymore.
Yeah.
We don't need our own memories. Mm-hmm. All those, how many billion mm-hmm. nerve cells have mm-hmm. we got?
Mm-hmm.
We won't need them anymore. Mm-hmm.
No, I completely agree. We have several breaks in history. One is the invention of writing. So the good example is Homer. All the poems of Homer have traditionally been transferred from generation to generation by the peasants, by learning it and then singing it for several days. The Odyssey was sung for several days. And then the Luther, inventing of paper, so he could nail it on the doors. And now we have here we are in the internet and in the artificial intelligence. That's the next step. So, yeah, I agree.
Actually, I disagree with you about memory is not going to be useful because in higher order thinking, if you don't have stuff in your memory, you can't use it.
Of course. But I'm making a prediction.
You're making a prediction.
Yeah.
Well,
that we're going to become more stupid because we're going to rely on what is the answer to this question?
Well, that's true. My students, you know, now in class, they don't.
Do you have to remember now how to solve a quadratic equation?
No, you do it based on Wolfram Alpha, right? Not me. I still remember the formula from when I was in the sixth grade or whenever I learned that.
No, but serious. That's exactly the question. That we have Watson now of IBM or other. The equivalent in Google, and again back to chemistry. The Google guys told me I'm a pharmacist. Sergey got interested in cancer research. Now we come to the ethics.
Yeah.
Sergey is the boss of Google. Since we have solved the problem with the self-driving cars. We will now solve the problem of cancer therapy. Our solution is simply debug the system. I completely agree. Nobody knows what is debugging and nobody knows what the system is. The argument was we are a self-learning system as the self-driving cars. And then I said, yeah, do the self-driving cars really work? And I said, come on. From time to time, they miss old people on the bike or the lady with a sun umbrella. So the car will drive over, but that is the learning effect. So we need some.
Yeah, so let's kill a few.
We need some, and then we have solved the problem. And then I said, so then stop this with cancer research. We do it since 150 years, so all of the people die, but we are a learning system. So,
So we had a question there. Go ahead.
I think that the Institute of Technology will educate people for the industry, and this area is somehow neglected in this discussion. And that's my question is, how could we behave ethically in the chemical industry, especially because the goal of a chemical plant is not making substances, but making money?
Exactly. That's one of the great tensions of the gift versus commodity economy, et cetera, which is that because we live in a capitalist society, and that's not going to change, there is a real tension between making money and, as it were, doing the right thing. Sometimes you make money doing the right thing, and sometimes, you know, and I understand that, because if you don't sell it, your company can't make it. So some of it is delving into business ethics, which some people also think is an oxymoron. But how much is a reasonable profit? Right? On the one hand, there's some people who say, well, this is the Donald Trump theory of life. The bigger the profit, the better you are. But I'm not sure that that's. I think we've lost something. It's just like at one time there's a concept of living wage that you should pay a living wage. We've lost that. You drive down the wage as low as you possibly can. So I think that kind of ethics, it's partly scientific ethics, but it's partly transcends scientific ethics and goes into, as I said, business ethics or societal ethics as to what, how do we think about these things as citizens of, you know, of our society.
You have to listen.
These are genuinely human issues. No, we have this issue in the United States about the so-called EpiPen, which is epinephrine, and there are these pens that people who have, you know, allergies carry, and the company that made them all of a sudden bounce the price up 400% so that young, poor people who needed these EpiPens couldn't afford them? And why did the price go up by a factor of four? Well, what are people trying to do? And, you know, as a socially responsible citizen, I would say they're just gouging. Because there was no reason given other than, you know, that somehow our production costs. I mean, this is known technology. It isn't as if they're, you know, a lot of times they say, well, we got to charge all this money because so we can do research, you know, and develop new pharmaceuticals. Although in the U.S., the pharmaceutical industry spends more on advertising than they do on research. So I think never would I say, you know, in my most socialist mind, I say, well, we should do something different. But in the real world, we can't do anything different. But the question is, you know, that's a whole different discussion. What are executive salaries of U.S. big U.S. corporations? They're just enormous. These people make, you know, $10 million a year. Who needs to make $10 million a year? What are you going to spend it on? You know, I'm not opposed to people making a nice living, but what are you going to do with $10 million a year? You're going to buy ten. You know, you're going to have your house in Luzon, and you're going to have your house in the Caribbean, and you're going to have a house in San Francisco. Who needs that kind of stuff? Is that a way of living one's life? But my influence with business executives is even less than my influence with chemists. So we probably need to close, right?
Yeah,
because it's now 3:30 and we're 15 minutes past our time.
Thank you very much for accepting me as a sparring partner.
Oh, it was fun. You know, I knew I liked him immediately because we both wear bow ties and okay, we both tie them. Thank you very much, everybody.
So the bird is back to the stuff. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank Gerd for animating this afternoon. Also, Jeff Kovac for basically provoking the discussion. I hope it's actually not the end of the discussion. Actually, I want you to take this as a take-home message. You know, it's just a start. How do we change the way we do science? Because if we keep going this way, we are going nowhere. And we know that only the long-term wins. And it's the same for business, actually. The only reason why business can last more than 100 years is because she's actually provided a real value to people. Otherwise, they will disappear. So with that, I need to give you two more information before we close the session. You still have Chem Together outside, which is, you know, for you to get a job. So this is also important, you know. And this is where you maybe can trade your value. And then there's actually tonight the special Spicer Award from the EPV, so I mean pharmaceutical science. So you have more things to do this afternoon besides research. In any case, I want to thank our speaker, our animator, and you for coming this afternoon. Thank you very much.